We can start.
Hello, good evening all. Today we are having the next session of OSCE or ODC series. So we were discussing the exam date is already out and we have only a few weeks left before the exam. We had tried to cover many of the important topics and as already discussed, we'll be having two more sessions, one on PALS and other on statistics most probably. And today we are having a class on nephrology, mainly renal tubulopathies. It is dealt by Dr. Rehana Rahman, who is the pediatric nephrologist in Aster MIMS Kozhikode. She had her MBBS in Government Medical College, Kozhikode. And then she had her MD pediatrics in Government Medical College, Thrissur. And then DM pediatric nephrology in St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. And now she is the pediatric nephrologist, consultant pediatric nephrologist in Aster MIMS Kozhikode. I welcome Dr. Rehana to discuss the topic. Rehana.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the introduction. Good evening, all. Today, the topic which we would be discussing is basically about renal tubular disorders. When Ajay was asking about an OSCE nephrology, I was not sure whether what topic will be usually asked in OSCE or as a spotters and all. Unlike other specialties, probably neurology, genetics and all, there is no much, scope for spotters and OSCE in nephrology. But what I found was renal tubulopathies is something which needs a systematic analysis and most of the time which can be kept as spotters or short questions and all. So I am not sure how much it will be of help to the postgraduates from the exam point of view, but I think renal tubular disorders, because they're being rare also, and sometimes it's difficult to see cases because of rarity. So I have tried myself to make it into a nutshell and try to make little interactive and all. So we'll move ahead with the session. So we all are fascinated by the renal tubules from our physiology classes. Though it was not a very easy topic, we have been dealing with all these mechanisms of tubular reabsorption, secretion, all those countercurrent mechanisms. All those were very fascinating from those physiology times. So what is most interesting about renal tubules is that it makes your 180 liters of glomerular filtrate into just 1 to 2 liters of urine. So much they are working, as you can see in this cartoon. So much they work to convert your 180 liters of glomerular filtrate into just 1 to 2 liters by doing all kind of reabsorption, all kind of work, and just in by that process maintaining the homeostasis of the organism. So this makes renal tubules something very interesting and fascinating. So my presentation would be basically about classification and concentrating on disorders causing renal tubular acidosis, and then about renal salt loss-causing tubulopathies, and few about the disorders of urinary concentration. So basically, what are renal tubulopathies? Renal tubulopathies are either genetic.
Madam, you may start sharing the screen.
Yes, sir. Say. You can't
screen
see.
Screen share team in the no, no. Screen then, share on. Ah, on the okay, okay, clear. Sorry, man.
Kana lole.
Kana, sorry.
Ah, okay, fine. So basically, renal tubulopathies are either genetic or acquired disorders of tubular reabsorption or secretion. And what to be interesting as it can be of individual metabolites or it can be of multiple metabolites. And as we know, genetic causes predominate in infancy and early childhood. So when we look into the disorders, they may have certain things in common. For example, they usually are associated with urinary concentrating capacity defects, which manifest clinically as polyuria. They are associated with abnormalities in acid regulation, which can cause acidosis, alkalosis. They are associated with abnormalities in electrolyte regulation, which causes dyselectrolytemia and clinical features of nephrocalcinosis. So these are certain common things which are can be found in renal tubular disorders. So in this background, we'll move ahead with the classification of the disorders. So physiologists usually prefer a classification based on the site of involvement, like disorders affecting proximal tubule, disorders affecting loop, disorders affecting distal nephron, that is the DCT and collecting duct, which altogether is called as aldosterone sensitive distal nephron, or we acronym is that ASDN. So these are the way this is the basis of classification usually physiologists follow. But for a clinician, for a treating pediatrician, it is very difficult to follow based on the site of involvement. So we follow something called as a syndromic classification, wherein we classify renal tubular syndromes into those syndromes with acidosis, metabolic acidosis, those syndromes with metabolic alkalosis, and those syndromes which neither has acidosis or alkalosis. And then there are a group which has individual metabolite absorption defects. And there is a group which causes hypertension. No wonder kidneys control your sodium and water levels. So they can cause disorders of tubules, definitely can cause hypertension also. So these are the syndromic classification of tubular disorders. With this background, we'll move into the individual disorders or into the classification flowchart. So renal tubulopathies, to keep it simple, we can classify to those associated with metabolic acidosis, that is which are associated with a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. Otherwise, what we call under the umbrella term, renal tubular acidosis. Those associated with metabolic alkalosis can be again classified based upon the blood pressure. Which group which has a low or normal blood pressure are usually the salt losing syndromes of Bartter and Gitelman. Whereas there is a group of syndromes with hypertension where you are retaining salt, those syndromes like Gordon syndrome and Liddle syndrome. And there are a group of multitude disorders which are not associated with any alkalosis or acidosis. They can be individual defects or free water absorption defects like nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, or individual metabolite absorption issues like glycosuria, cystinuria, hypophosphatemic rickets, then magnesium disorders. So there are a multitude of disorders, and it is not possible to deal with all those things. But what we'll be discussing or concentrating on today's discussion would be the entities marked in red. That is basically the RTA, and the salt losing nephropathies and nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Our discussion will be concentrating on these three areas, and the rest will not be covered. So before moving ahead into any of the tubular pathology, I think we should just brush up our physiology, where what is exactly happening in the tubules in a very simple way. So we'll start from the proximal tubule. So proximal tubule, when we hear, we know that the majority of absorption of most of the molecules, whether it is water, sodium, all things happen at the level of proximal tubules. As you can see in the picture, it is an important site for bicarbonate reabsorption. And the two transporters which are important is the apical sodium hydrogen exchanger, NHE, and the basolateral sodium bicarbonate exchanger, NBCE1. So these are the two transporters essential for a bicarbonate reabsorption, and definitely are carbonic anhydrase enzymes, isoforms 2 and 4. So to keep it simple, these are the things needed for bicarbonate reabsorption, and majority of bicarbonate is reabsorbed in the proximal tubule. But proximal tubule does much more. It reabsorbs, as you can see in the bottom part of the picture, it reabsorbs glucose, amino acids, phosphates, and as you can see in the upper part of the picture, there are receptor mediated endocytosis also, which is happening in the proximal tubules. And there is paracellular absorption of calcium and all. And there is inside the cell, there is something called as ammonia generation happening. So it is a highly metabolically active cell doing many things. And maybe to keep it nutshell, it is the bicarbonate reabsorption, which is the most important thing. And there are many more other things which is happening at the proximal convoluted tubule level. So when we move ahead from this, we reach the distal tubule. We'll not be discussing loop here because it is coming under the disorders causing alkalosis. So we'll discuss it there. Now, when we come to the distal tubules, that is a distal convoluted tubule and collecting duct, there are these type A intercalated cells, which is again a very important cell in your acid regulation. So bicarbonate reabsorption and ammonia generation happens at PCT level. But when an organism is faced with an acid load or there is a stress in the form of an acidosis, to overcome that, we need to excrete acids as titrable acidity, which is either as ammonia or combined with phosphate ions. So we have to secrete protons. So this distal convoluted tubule type I intercalated cells are the key cells involved in secreting protons and controlling acid-base status at the time of an acidosis acid load. So here the important molecules are the H plus ATPase in the apical side and the anion exchanger, that is a bicarbonate chloride exchanger in the basolateral side, and definitely carbonic anhydrase enzyme also. And the same pathway also has an involvement in ammonia generation. The ammonia generated in the proximal convoluted tubule by reaches the distal tubule and gets secreted along with protons as ammonia. So this is one of the important sites wherein acid, when organism is faced with an acid stress, wherein they can adjust or they can excrete the extra acid. So most of the time, this is the most important site of acid regulation. And being distal, it is the final site of acid regulation as well. Now moving ahead into the other cell type in the distal tubule, that is the principal cells, which is otherwise known as having aldosterone receptors. So this area of the tubule, distal convoluted tubule, is otherwise called as an aldosterone sensitive distal nephron. They are characterized by the presence of aldosterone receptors, mineralocorticoid receptors, in the basolateral side. When activated, result in the insertion of epithelial sodium channels. This epithelial sodium channels are very important in your sodium reabsorption at the distal level, and it has an indirect control over potassium secretion by the ROMK channels, and it indirectly also controls ammonia secretion in the distal tubules. So overall, aldosterone has a role of sodium absorption, and to keep it simple, have a role in sodium reabsorption. Aldosterone causes sodium reabsorption and potassium excretion. So this, keeping in mind these three sites of renal tubules, we'll move ahead into the individual entities. So when should we suspect a renal tubular acidosis? There are various clinical features like growth retardation or failure to grow, polyuria, polydipsia, preference for savory foods, refractory rickets, recurrent vomiting, episodic weakness and paralysis, constipation, and presence of parental consanguinity and positive family history. So in this background, if you are clinically suspecting an RTA, you evaluate. And most of the time, it is not compulsory to have an arterial blood gas. For a renal tubular acidosis evaluation, a venous blood gas itself is enough. There is maybe it's difficult to get arterial blood gas. So most of the time, venous blood gas is a very good starting point. So you have a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, but rarely there may be a coexisting high anion gap metabolic acidosis if the RTA is complicated with some renal dysfunction, or if there is any other entity causing a high anion gap metabolic acidosis, there may be a mixed disorder. Otherwise, you have a pure normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. So in a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, always you have to rule out other causes, particularly GI loss of bicarb, either diarrheal loss or loss from some duodenal aspirate or duodenal aspirates, and another important entity being sodium chloride infusion. So here, to rule out the other causes, here comes the importance of what is called as an urine anion gap. So in this background, I will just discuss urine anion gap. So we are all familiar. I know that you all will be familiar with the plasma anion gap or serum anion gap, which we calculate for an ABG analysis. And urine anion gap is something different, wherein the formulas are not the same. So what is urine anion gap? In a nutshell, it is just a surrogate marker of the urinary ammonia. So we know that when an organism is faced with an acid stress or an acid load, your distal tubule is supposed to secrete protons as ammonium. So that means your urinary ammonium will increase. So, and this ammonia, it is very difficult to measure directly. So, as a surrogate, we calculate something called as an urine anion gap. And normally, in normal conditions, urine anion gap is positive. And it is constituted by ammonium ions. As you can see in the left side of picture, what happens is there is a large amount of ammonia. There is normal acidification. So there is large, and these two pictures are in presence of acidosis. In presence of acidosis, if ammonia is excreted normally, if the distal tubules are working normally, there is large amount of ammonia in the urine. And when we calculate, what we get is a negative urine anion gap, because the chlorides will be more than the sum of the sodium and potassium. So we get a negative anion gap or a negative urinary anion gap if your distal tubules are normally secreting ammonium. That is, if the distal acidification is intact. So that will be the picture in any GI loss of bicarb or GI reasons for acidosis. That will be the picture. Whereas when you compare to the right picture on the right hand side, there is no enough ammonia. That is, your distal acidification is not intact. So what happens is, the ammonia is mostly secreted as ammonium chloride. Ammonia goes in urine as ammonium chloride. So the chlorides are also less, and the sum is always, the sodium plus potassium sum is more than the chloride, and thus result in a positive urinary anion gap. So positive urinary anion gap in the presence of an acidotic milieu suggests that your distal acidification is not correct. So this is the in nutshell. And there are, the urine anion gap has its own fallacies, and in some scenario you have to use urine osmolal gap, which is beyond our discussion today. So we won't be discussing that. So we move back to the algorithm. So you have done a urine anion gap, it is positive, or you have ruled out the GI losses. Now you can see, look at the urine pH. If the urine pH is consistently more than 5.3 or 5.5 in some books they say, and you see that serum potassium is low or normal, fractional bicarbonate is less than 5%, and urine blood carbon dioxide gradient is less than 20, it points towards a distal renal tubular acidosis or type 1 RTA. And then these distal RTAs are usually primary renal disorders, and not part of, usually they are a primary renal disorders, but they have associated hypercalciuria. They can be associated with sensory neural hearing loss and hemolytic anemia. So you need screening for all those. Whereas in the other limb, you have an urine pH, which is less than 5.3, and the bicarbonate excretion, there is bicarbonate excretion is more than 5%, fractional excretion of bicarbonate. And you get a, you can go into two ways, either a low or normal serum potassium. It points towards a proximal RTA, and or proximal RTA, or otherwise called as type 2 RTA. Usually proximal RTAs are secondary to systemic disorders, and systemic disorders we'll be discussing in detail. And so, and proximal RTA is usually associated with other tubular dysfunction like glucosuria, amino aciduria, phosphaturia, low molecular weight proteinuria. So that will point towards a proximal renal tubular acidosis. Whereas in the other limb, we have a high serum potassium, which points towards a type 4 RTA, which is usually secondary to some renal diseases or secondary to aldosterone disorder, disorders affecting aldosterone system. So these can manifest as a type 4 RTA, which is in hyperkalemic RTA. So this is in nutshell the classification of the RTA and the basic lab investigations which we can see. So we'll move ahead with the proximal RTA or Fanconi syndrome. So the important question here is the proximal RTA and Fanconi syndrome same? So here in the picture, you can see the Guido Fanconi. He was actually a pediatrician, a Swiss pediatrician, who described this Fanconi syndrome. So Fanconi syndrome is actually a global proximal tubular dysfunction. And so it constitutes all the features of PCT dysfunction, including hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, bicarbonaturia, phosphaturia, proteinuria, glycosuria, and amino aciduria. So everything together constitute called what is called as Fanconi syndrome. And the acidosis part only is actually called as proximal RTA, though we use it interchangeably. Most of the time, proximal RTA and Fanconi are used interchangeably. In true sense, Fanconi syndrome refers to global dysfunction of proximal tubule. So what are the causes of Fanconi syndrome? They can be usually, I already told, it's usually part of systemic diseases rather than primary renal problems. So again, it can be genetic disorders or hereditary disorders or acquired disorders. There are multitude of disorders. In hereditary, you have disorders like Dent disease, Lowy's, cystinosis, galactosemia, GSD, styrosinemia, Wilson, etc. In acquired, you have sometimes post AKI. And another important thing is vitamin D deficiency, hyperparathyroidism, severe vitamin D deficiency. Sometimes you can see, I think this was discussed in Nelson also in those days, like vitamin D deficiency causing a Fanconi-like picture. And there are a multitude of drugs which can also cause Fanconi-like picture, basically a global proximal tubular dysfunction. So there are multiple causes, but definitely hereditary causes predominate in the early childhood. So we'll move ahead with few cases so that to make it interesting and probably for the OSCE point of view. So this is a 1-year-old girl, baby, born out of a consanguineous parentage. There is failure to thrive, polyuria and rickets. On evaluation, child has a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. She has hypophosphatemia, hypokalemia, glucosuria and amino aciduria. So the question here is, identify the eye finding. What is the diagnosis? How to confirm the diagnosis and what are the associated endocrine defects in this condition? So I think someone can answer or
they can put in the chat box.
Yeah. Yeah, I think answers have started coming. Yeah, cystinosis, cataract. Yeah, cystine crystalline cornea. Absolutely. So what is this? This above picture, I don't know how much it is clear. These are the cystine crystals in the cornea, which can be seen in cystinosis. And the diagnosis is definitely cystinosis. So cystinosis, a few words about cystinosis. Cystinosis is actually a lysosomal storage disorder, which is inherited in autosomal recessive. It's a transporter defect resulting in accumulation of cystine in different organs. And it characteristically presents as Fanconi syndrome in the early childhood. It has a risk of progression to chronic kidney disease. And the cystine ultimately accumulates in every organ and usually endocrine organs. Eye is affected, like eyes, we already saw the picture. Endocrine organs like thyroid is affected, pancreas is affected. So they can develop hypothyroidism, diabetes mellitus, all those things, or endocrine deficiencies can develop. And the other question was about how to confirm the diagnosis. So confirmation diagnosis, there is initially they were doing RBC cystine levels like that. But now definitely, as you can see in the slide, genetic diagnosis, looking for a pathogenic variation in the CTNS gene is the confirmatory for the diagnosis. And endocrine defects we already discussed. So this is cystinosis. And is there a drug of choice? Yes, there is a drug available for cysteamine, which bypasses the cystine transport system. Unfortunately, this is not available in India. So a long way to go. So cysteamine is a drug of choice, and early beginning of cysteamine definitely helps or prevent child from developing chronic kidney failure. That is the highlight of this disease. We'll move ahead with the second case. It's a 5-year-old boy, born out of non-consanguineous parentage, history of rickets and polyuria. There is a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, hypophosphatemia, low molecular weight proteinuria. There is history of renal failure for uncle, that is the mother's brother. So first question is, what is the X-ray picture? What is the diagnosis? What inheritance does you think this disease has? What is the eye finding? So we'll wait for the answers. Yes, absolutely. Nephrocalcinosis is the, and it is extensive nephrocalcinosis. Okay. So what is the disease? X-linked dominant is the inheritance. Okay. Fine, we'll move ahead. So the first question is X-ray picture, that is extensive nephrocalcinosis. The diagnosis is what is called as Dent's disease. The inheritance is actually X-linked recessive. So this, as you can see, this is a boy. And so this diagnosis, and this affected patient is mother's brother, again, a male. So the inheritance is actually X-linked recessive, not X-linked dominant. And the disease is Dent's disease. We'll discuss it further. So these Dent's disease and Lowy's disease are two twin disorders, or in fact, similar disorders. They are X-linked disorders associated with proximal tubular dysfunction due to the defect in the endocytic pathway. And what is important is both of these disorders can lead to a later progression to end-stage renal disease. Dent's disease usually present as partial Fanconi with low molecular weight proteinuria, amino aciduria, glucosuria, hyperphosphaturia, and potassium calureuresis. Lowy syndrome, and usually the manifestations are limited to kidneys. But Lowy's is something which is otherwise called as oculocerebrorenal syndrome. You have manifestations of eyes in the form of cataract, glaucoma, in the brain manifestations in the form of mental retardation, seizures, behavioral disorders, and definitely Fanconi syndrome pertaining to renal. What is interesting is these are caused by different mutations. One is a chloride channel and one is an OCRL mutation, Lowy syndrome. And the question in one of our question was, what is the eye finding? So eye finding in Lowy is definitely cataract and glaucoma, but Dent's disease also can have eye finding in the form of vitamin A deficiency signs, because Dent's disease, there will be massive low molecular weight proteinuria. So our vitamin A binding globulin, thyroid binding globulin, all these things are lost. And so they are prone for developing vitamin A deficiency, hypothyroidism, and also they can have findings of vitamin A deficiency, I mean, in a Dent child. Whereas in Lowy's, you have multiple findings. You can have vitamin A deficiency finding as well as you can have findings particular to Lowy's like cataract and glaucoma. So these are the two cases. We'll move ahead. Okay, in the background of this particular proximal RTA or Fanconi syndrome, we'll just concentrate on this picture. So identify this picture. Anyone can come up with this answer for this picture? What is this picture? Yeah, the answer is in a way correct. I don't know. It is, this picture is used in hypophosphatemic rickets. Yeah. So this picture is used for... correct. So this picture is basically, what is the name of the picture? It's called Walton and Bijovet normogram. So it is used for calculating or looking for phosphaturia. So basically, when we want to prove that there is urinary phosphate loss, we look for a fractional excretion of phosphate, which we do like any other fractional excretion. We do FeNA, like that we can do fractional excretion of phosphate. And when we reduce that fractional excretion, 1 minus fractional excretion will give you the tubular reabsorption. But that will be fallacious in the presence of hypophosphatemia. And basically, the tubular reabsorption of phosphorus is, it's not an independent end. It depends on two things. One is, it depends on the GFR. Second thing is, it depends upon the serum phosphate. So it's not an independent entity. So to correct this two variables, that is the GFR and the serum phosphate or plasma phosphate, we have to find out TMP GFR, that is tubular maximum of phosphate corrected to the GFR. For that purpose, we use this normogram and we match the TRP against the plasma phosphate levels and we keep a scale and derive the TMP GFR from this normogram. There are formula also for calculating, but this normogram is something which is used for calculating, for finding out the TMP GFR. And in the presence of hypophosphatemia, any TMP GFR more than 2.8 is considered as significant, or it is considered positive for phosphate loss, phosphaturia. Okay. So we'll move ahead with the various preparations which we use in managing renal tubular disorders. So the first one is Julie solution, and the other one is Scholl solution. These are the old medications. Most of them are old, we were using from olden days, but now we have new preparations like phosphorus sachets are there, and there is solutions of bicarbonate. There are solutions of potassium citrate rather than Scholl solution. So the question here is, what are the contents of these solution. Basically about Joule's and Scholes, I'm asking. Potassium citrate, it's quite self-explanatory. What is its content? Yeah, answers are coming. Actively, everyone is answering. So Joule's solution is basically, it is a phosphoric acid and sodium diphosphates. And approximately 1 ml will give 1 milliequivalents. And Scholl's solution is a combination of sodium citrate and citric acid. And what is actually now, we prefer to give potassium citrate rather than sodium citrate or Scholl's, because most of this time we need potassium supplementation also. So rather than Scholl's, potassium citrate is preferred. Though we have been using Scholl's solution for a long time, potassium citrate is preferred. And Joule's solution, the palatability, availability, all those things are difficult. So we have moved to actually sachets of phosphorus, like you have phosphorus sachets available, which is more easier, have more shelf life and difficult, it's easy to procure and all. So, but these are some drugs which were being used for some time, and we need to know basically about the contents. So we'll move away from the proximal renal tubular acidosis to distal renal tubular acidosis. Here, there is an inability to maximally decrease the urine pH. There is inability to increase urinary ammonium excretion, as we saw in the initial slides. That is especially in the presence of a metabolic acidosis. It is associated with hypokalemia. There is nephrocalcinosis, and there is association with sensory neural hearing loss and hemolytic anemia. We'll again go back to two patients. The first patient is a 2-year-old boy. There is failure to thrive, polyuria and rickets. There are episodes of paralysis, history of speech delay, and there is nephrocalcinosis. Whereas on the other side, there is a 12-year-old girl. It's episodes of hypokalemic paralysis. There is no failure to thrive, no rickets, doubtful polyuria, and there is some parotid swelling. When evaluated, both of these patients had distal RTA. So my question here is, what could be the etiology in patient one, and what about the second patient? I saw one answer as Alport. No, Alport is totally a different disorder. It's a glomerular basement membrane disorder, and it has nothing to do with tubules. So this is different. This is distal RTA. So I'm just bringing into your attention, there can be different causes for distal RTA. It need not be inherited always. We'll move ahead with the discussion. So etiology of distal RTA, it can be genetic and it can be acquired. So our first child is having AH plus ATPA subunit defect probably because he has some speech delay. Maybe his hearing is abnormal, we don't know. So he's likely to have, he's likely to have a genetic distal RTA, most probably an H plus ATPA subunit defect because he has probably a hearing defect. So that is what pointing towards that. Whereas the other child you can see is an adolescent girl. And she has not all the features of distal RTA, but she has hypokalemic paralysis. And what is interesting is that in the acquired or in this adolescent age group, autoimmune causes of distal RTA, especially Sjogren and SLE presenting as distal RTA are common. And there are many drugs which can cause distal RTA like amphotericin B, lithium, and disease like sickle cell, Wilson and sarcoid can also cause distal RTA. And in distal RTA, what is interesting is there is this entity called hypercalciuria and hypocitrituria. And distal RTA is wherein you have a high propensity for nephrocalcinosis and high propensity for renal calculi. So hypercalciuria, what amounts to hypercalciuria? It is the calcium excretion more than 4 milligram per kg per day in 24 hours. That is the definition for hypercalciuria in very simple term. There are multiple definitions based on age and all, depending upon the calcium creatinine ratio. If you consider 24 hours, it's more than 4 milligram per kg per day. And hypocitrituria is amounts for a citrate in 24 hours less than 2 milligram per kg per day. both in 24-hour sample. And so the point to be noted is distal RTA can be genetic, it can be acquired. And there is this entity called incomplete distal RTA. So incomplete distal RTA is something which is totally different, wherein you does not have any evidence of systemic acidosis or distal ectulitemia, but the acidosis is there at the renal tubular level. And so they have acidosis in the inside the kidney, but not in the system because of some partial defects. So they present with renal calculi and nephrocalcinosis. And they are usually diagnosed by provocation test. We have this ammonium chloride loading test or furosemide, fludrocortisone, all provocation, acid provocation tests can reveal the defect. But usually they present with, and they are common in adulthood rather than childhood. That is an entity called incomplete distal RTA. So moving ahead, we have the type 4 RTA. So here the clinical scenario will be some 2-month-old boy with PUV post-fulguration. He has a normal serum creatinine, but has hyperkalemia and a normal anion gap metabolic acidosis. So we classify this as type 4 RTA. So my question here is, what is the cause for, in this case, what is the cause of type 4 RTA? And what are the other causes? I see some answers. Absolutely, it is the aldosterone resistance, and that is the that's a perfect answer. So cause of type 4 RTA in this scenario is aldosterone resistance. So again, you have multitude of causes for type 4 RTA. So there are a group of genetic causes wherein there are mutations for the multiple receptors which we saw in the aldosterone sensitive distal nephron, which can be the mineralocorticoid receptor, ENaC receptor. And these all cause salt losing tubulopathies and result in potassium retention, because at the same time, aldosterone is involved in potassium secretion also. So our pseudohypoaldosteronism type 1, both autosomal recessive and autosomal dominant types, as well as our salt losing CAH, all these has the clinical manifestation called as type 4 RTA. Whereas in the acquired disorders, like the child whom we have, there is an aldosterone resistance, probably because of long-term obstruction. Aldosterone receptors are dysfunctional, or the distal nephrons are being damaged. So there is aldosterone deficiency can also lead to similar picture as in the context of an Addison, or using of drugs like AC inhibitors, ARBs or NSAIDs, or as we saw in this particular child, that is aldosterone resistance. And which is sometimes we call as a transient pseudohypoaldosteronism, we otherwise call. It is this type of a clinical picture which we see in a context of obstructive uropathy like PUV. So the basic reason or basic etiology is an aldosterone resistance. So that is about type 4 RTA. Now there is an entity called type 3 RTA, which is very rare and which has mixed features of both type 1 and type 2. And basically, it is because the problem is here at carbonic anhydrase level, and it is being used up in both sites. They have other manifestations like osteopetrosis, cerebral calcification, and mental retardation. And this is a very rare entity. So we'll just revise what we have seen, just comparing the proximal RTA. So we know that proximal RTA has a low potassium, serum bicarbonate usually in the range of 15 to 18, but note that urine calcium is normal. Other tubular disorders are present. Nephrocalcinosis is usually absent, except in dense disease. Dense disease is it's an exception. And rickets are common. In distal RTA, you can see that the bicarb is very low usually, but fractional bicarb excretion is also low. And urine calcium is high. Other tubular defects are absolutely absent. Rickets is usually present, nephrocalcinosis is present. Type 4 RTA, you have again a similar picture to proximal RTA, but you have a high potassium and there is usually no nephrocalcinosis or other tubular defects. And rickets is totally absent in a type 4 RTA. Okay, so this is in nutshell about renal tubular acidosis. So we'll move away from renal tubular disorders to disorders of loop or salt losing tubulopathies. So we have the Bartter and Gittleman syndromes. They are otherwise called as hereditary salt-losing tubulopathies. They are autosomal recessive disorders with hypokalemia, characterized by hypokalemia, metabolic acid alkalosis, urinary wasting of sodium, potassium, and chloride, and which consequently result in hyperreninemia and secondary hyperaldosteronism. And there is usually elevated urinary prostaglandin levels, and plus minus hypomagnesemia will be there in some disorders like Gittleman. So basically, this approach is towards a child with failure to thrive, hypokalemia, having metabolic alkalosis. So you have causes of chloride responsive alkalosis, which we know, vomiting or diuretics and all. Whereas there is a group of chloride unresponsive, which is characterized with normal BP. You have Bartter and Gittleman. With hypertension, you have various entities like Liddle, primary hyperaldosteronism, and renal artery stenosis. So we won't be discussing all those. We'll be just discussing the Bartter and Gittleman, that is for falling under the chloride resistant normotensive metabolic alkalosis. So before moving ahead into, we'll just brush up our physiology again. So here the area of interest is loop. We know that thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. This is the site where urine is getting concentrated. Just remember the word countercurrent mechanism. There is so much physiology involved. We'll not be discussing all those things, but it is the site of urinary concentration. And collecting ducts is the site of urinary dilution actually. So here is urine getting concentrated, and the site of interest, there are in this picture, you can see various transporters. In the apical side, you have the NKCC or the furosemide sensitive, the loop diuretic sensitive transporter, that is a sodium potassium chloride co-transporter. And then you have the potassium transporter, which is called ROMC channels. Then you have sodium potassium ATPase, then your calcium sensory receptor. All these receptors are involved in a concentrating mechanism, and the most important receptor being the furosemide sensitive NKCC. So here is the maximal concentration of urine happening. And at the same time, when we move to the distal convoluted tubule, here the sodium chloride transporter is called NCC or sodium chloride co-transporter. And at DCT level, we have other transporters transporting calcium, magnesium, and all are also there. So in this background, we'll look back into the disorders. And here, one interesting thing is here in this loop, as well as in the loop, thick ascending limb of loop of Henle, you have the calcium and magnesium transport happening in the paracellular pathway, that is in between the cells. So identify the species. What are the features of the species? The answer has also come. I'm sorry about that. Anyway, this is Bartter facies. So the features of Bartter facies are usually discussed as triangular shaped face, prominent forehead, large eyes, protruding ears, and drooping mouth. So this is something described as Bartter facies, and the answer had already come. So sorry about that. So this is the Bartter facies, which is described classically in antenatal Barters. So we'll just go back to the discussion in the context of three patients. So we have three patients here. First patient is a 1 year, 4 month old boy with failure to gain weight and history of polyuria. There is antenatal history of polyhydramnios. The baby is normotensive. And you have a 4 month old baby with recurrent episodes of pneumonia and chronic diarrhea. Then you have a 2 year old child with UTI who have received a high dose amikacin from elsewhere, comes with hypokalemia. What is interesting is that when we did a lab evaluation, basically the venous blood gas and electrolytes were similar in all these three patients. So you see that there is a metabolic alkalosis, and there is a hypochloremia and hypokalemia and hyponatremia, and the creatinine is normal, GFR is normal. So this is the basic, there is a common lab picture, but children have different history. So in this context, we discuss Bartter and Bartter mimics. So Bartter, it is very clear that it is a urinary chloride loss. And so what test will differentiate the first child from second child? So first child from the second child, what test will be? Absolutely, that is a urinary chloride. The test which will differentiate will be urine chloride. So it will be urinary chloride loss in a Bartter. So that will differentiate from a Bartter mimic like other extra renal loss of chloride. So just looking back into the loop of Henle, you have the type 1 Bartter syndrome, which is the receptor NKCC defect, which is causing type 1 Bartter. It is again antenatal presentation. Type 2 Bartter is affecting the potassium channels. That is again antenatal Bartter. Type 3 is affecting the chloride channels, otherwise called as CLCKB channel. And type 4 is affecting the Bartin, which is associated with the hearing loss, Bartin defect. And type 5 is affecting the calcium sensing receptor. So these five Bartter syndromes are concentrating on the thick ascending loop of Henle's cell. Defects in these result in genetic causes of Bartter syndrome. As we know that antenatal Bartter syndrome can be due to type 1 and type 2, that is so NKCC or ROMK. They usually present in the antenatal period with polyhydramnios. There may be history of prematurity. There can be polyuria, growth retardation, and dehydration. And usually they have associated nephrocalcinosis. And type 4 is the one with sensory neural deafness. They also present in antenatal period and has a similar manifestations except for the presence of sensory neural hearing loss. Type 3 or the classic Bartter is the Bartter which presents in late childhood or infancy. I mean, not presenting in the antenatal period. They don't have history of polyhydramnios. They also have polyuria. It is not that severe. The growth retardation and all is compared to the antenatal Bartter, it is less. Whereas a type 5 defect is totally a different entity wherein they have some associated issues also like hypocalcemia, hypercalciuria and all. It is beyond our discussion because it is actually a calcium sensing receptor defect and has symptoms like parathyroid issues are also there. Type 5 Bartter is something different and our characteristic antenatal Bartter are type 1 and type 2 caused by the sodium potassium co-transporter and the potassium channel, ROMK channel. So this is in nutshell the classification of the different Bartter syndromes. Now moving ahead with Bartter syndrome mimics. So we sometimes use the term pseudo-Bartter syndrome. So here there is an extra renal loss of sodium chloride and commonest scenario being vomiting. But what we have discussed in the second child who had a chronic diarrhea and recurrent pneumonia is probably cystic fibrosis, where there's an extra renal loss of chloride, probably from the sweat chloride loss. And there can be acquired Bartter syndrome, which we discussed in the third child who had received aminoglycosides. Aminoglycoside toxicity can cause a acquired Bartter syndrome and definitely diuretic toxicity because it is the exactly a loop diuretic receptor is the one involved in Bartter. So these can cause acquired Bartter syndrome. So we'll move further. So there is this again a child who is an 8-year-old boy presenting with recurrent episodes of tetany. He gives history of muscle cramps and weakness. Evaluation shows normal calcium, low magnesium and low potassium. So he has metabolic alkalosis and hypocalciuria. So what is the diagnosis? Yeah, it is nothing but Gittleman syndrome. So Gittleman syndrome, as we already told, it is the defect of the sodium chloride co-transporter in the distal convoluted tubule. And as I already told, there are some other transporters also happening along with it being calcium and you have the magnesium transporter. So these defects usually by causing voltage abnormalities indirectly causes magnesium absorption defects, not being directly, but indirectly by creating abnormal voltages and all at the tubular level can cause abnormal magnesium loss. That differentiates Bartter from Gittleman. So when will we suspect Gittleman syndrome? So there was usually these children are bigger children compared to the age of Bartters. They will have a chronic hypokalemia with renal potassium wasting, metabolic alkalosis, and hypomagnesemia with renal magnesium wasting. They have a hypocalciuria. They usually have a high fractional excretion of chloride, a low or low normal BPs. Usually they have normal renal ultrasound, unlike Bartter subtypes where you have hypercalciuria, nephrocalcinosis. Usually there is hypocalciuria and there is no nephrocalcinosis in Gittleman. And definitely genetic diagnosis is the confirmatory diagnosis. So we'll again start our comparison between Bartter and Gittleman. So Bartter is very rarely asymptomatic. Usually it can be prenatal, neonatal, early infancy, usually in early onset. Growth retardation, polyuria is very common. Hypomagnesemia is rare, but may be there. Urine calcium is usually high and concentrating mechanism is severely disturbed because loop is the area where you have your urine is getting concentrated. And so it is severely disturbed and you have extensive polyuria. At the same time, Gittleman is usually late presentation. It can be even asymptomatic and detecting in some after doing some ECG showing arrhythmias like that and all is possible to detect Gittleman and finding out a low magnesium levels. And growth retardation, polyuria and are always absent, but hypomagnesemia is must. And usually it is hypocalciuria. And concentrating mechanism is only slightly disturbed. So polyuria need not be a major manifestation in Gittleman. So we'll move ahead to the last part of our discussion, wherein we will involve our brain and kidneys. So here is the connection between brain and kidneys. So as the control of sodium and control of water, indirectly they control each other. And that lies in the antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin and collecting tubule. So this is the brain kidney connection, which is happening at the collecting duct level, which ultimately determines your sodium levels and maintain the tissue homeostasis. So we'll move ahead with the what is called as the nephrogenic DI. So here we know that, again back to physiology, we know that water absorption is through aquaporin channels. It happens everywhere in the tubule, ranging from proximal tubule, but the ultimate end point or the final destination of urinary dilution or free water excretion or free water retention is at the level of collecting duct cell. And it is basically based on the presence of adrenaline vasopressin or ADH hormone. So what I want to concentrate is on the presence of what is given in the red box. So here you have to, when the collecting duct with the presence of arginine vasopressin, you see that all aquaporin channels are being inserted on the apical side and water is being absorbed. Whereas when it is absent, they are all inactive. There is no apical insertion of aquaporin channels once the AVP is absent. So this is the final site of free water excretion or free water retention. So keeping this in mind, we'll again move into diabetes insipidus. And central diabetes insipidus is not an area of discussion because it is an endocrine area. Maybe it is already covered also. So what we discuss will be nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. It can be congenital or genetic nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, or it can be secondary. So congenital is usually due to the insensitivity of the distal nephron to antidiuretic effects of ADH. And kidney loses its ability to concentrate, leading to severe dehydration and electrolyte imbalance. Whereas secondary NDI can be due to many renal diseases. It can be induced by drugs, and some biochemical abnormalities can also induce secondary nephrogenic diabetes insipidus or NDI. So what are the causes of secondary NDI? Again, disorders like PUV, obstructive uropathies, disorders like sickle cell disease, renal dysplasias, post AKI. All this, when predominantly the collecting duct area is affected, there can be abnormal receptors of the arginine vasopressin. A receptor level resistance can develop and it can result in a nephrogenic DI. There are drugs which can affect like lithium, ifosfamide, amphotericin B. There are biochemical abnormalities like hypercalcemia, hypokalemia, chronic hypercalcemia, chronic hypokalemia can cause concentrating defects by causing secondary nephrogenic DI. So these are the basic causes. Whereas the congenital causes are 90% X-linked recessive. So boys are predominantly affected. That is the activating mutations in the AVP receptor gene. And there are milder mutations which can cause partial pictures also, partial NDI picture. Whereas there are 10% is having inheritance as autosomal recessive or dominant, wherein the mutation is in the aquaporin channel and not in the ADH or not in the V2 receptor, but in the aquaporin channel. So this is the basic underlying reason for congenital nephrogenic DI. So what are the clinical features? The urinary concentrating defect is present since birth, but usually they don't have defect in utero. And symptoms start from the first few weeks of life, and breastfed infants thrive well because it's usually breast milk is a low sodium diet. Whereas when they are formula fed, they are more prone for hypernatremic dehydration. They present with irritability, poor feeding, poor weight gain, and seizures may be the presentation. childhood they may present with milder defects may escape the infancy and may present in childhood or secondary defects may present later in childhood with nocturia, nocturnal enuresis, polyuria, polydipsia, signs of dehydration. And classically, an NDI does not have an antenatal history of polyhydramnios. So what is the principle of evaluation? Again, we'll move to the what is called as a water deprivation test. So here, what is test we are checking is the inability to concentrate urine when we are subjected to dehydration. It suggests DI, that it suggests diabetes insipidus. That is, there is no rise in urine osmolality when there is a rise in serum osmolality. And clinically, you are seeing dehydration. And after water deprivation, you are giving arginine vasopressin. And if there is a failure to increase urine osmolality after intranasal or IV vasopressin, it is diagnostic of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So what is water deprivation test? Actually, it is most of the time now obsolete. When you have a classical clinical feature, genetic diagnosis has outweighed this. But still, for exam purpose and all, I think we should know water deprivation test. Where it is usually done in morning hours. You have an 8-hour test period, restrict fluid intake, dry food is usually allowed, and your child is weighed, and child is weighed after emptying the bladder, and you have to monitor the urine output very reliably, so may have to put an Intellink catheter, plus minus, and measure the baseline plasma and urine osmolality, check hourly body weight. Then after the start of the test, you have to measure the amount of urine, urine osmolality, serum sodium, plasma osmolality every 2 hourly for 8 hours. And stop the test if serum sodium is more than 150, body weight is dropping more than 3%, or serum osmolality more than 300. Most of the time when the child presents itself, if we satisfy this criteria, we usually get away without doing water deprivation. Especially it is very difficult to do a water deprivation, a classic water deprivation test in infants, in small children. So most of the time it's a very theoretical, but at times we definitely do. In bigger children, it is easier. So after this, what vasopressin test, and when the urine osmolality continues remains low, you try giving vasopressin to prove whether it is a central DI or nephrogenic DI. So if it is central DI, definitely your osmolality is going to improve. So we have again the chart wherein you have various findings after starting a water deprivation test. So at the thirst, the urine volume, the urine osmolality, plasma osmolality, and ADH test. So which are the diagnosis? The diagnosis is given in the last slide. So you can tell. I mean, the first one, second one, like that, you can put whichever diagnosis. Needs some time, so I'll wait probably. Yeah, I will only go ahead. So the first one is a normal condition, normal state, wherein you have a corresponding increase in the urine osmolality. You are fasting or you are dehydrated, your urine osmolality increase so as to keep your plasma osmolality normal. So it's a normal. Whereas in the primary polydipsia, your urine volume decrease, but urine osmolality increase. And plasma osmolality is usually low normal. Whereas in the central diabetes and nephrogenic diabetes, the picture is similar. Only difference being after an ADH test, their urine osmolality increases by 50%. Whereas in NDI, there is no increase. So this is about the water deprivation test. And about treatment part and all, I will not be discussing. This is my last slide. I'm finishing my discussion. Thanks for active participation. Thank you once again. Any questions or doubts are welcomed.
Habib Rahman, you can unmute and ask.
One second. I will make. One second.
It was an excellent class.
Now you can unmute. Habib Rahman, you can unmute.
Habib.
Dr. Ehan, I think almost everything has been cleared in the topics.
Ah,
so it was very crisp and clear. I think these are very difficult topics for everyone to, maybe they need to go back and read once more and grasp again and again. Because RT
is
a very difficult topic for, I think, for the exam part.
Yeah.
The examples were quite good. It was a nice presentation.
Thank you. It's not a very common topic, but actually they were actively involving. Thanks to them, because I was also not very sure how to present it in a waskiable or interactable format. So they were actively involved in answering. Thanks to them.
Sabik, okay. I think we'll wind up session. But before that, I'll just Sabik just.
Okay, this is the 11th session, I think, in the our grade series of OSCE for this exam going students. It was a wonderful session by Dr. Rehana K. Rahman. She has covered almost many important areas of nephrology that may be asked in the exams. So I would like to sincerely thank for her efforts. Also all the participants who were actively participating in the session and made the class very lively. And also Dr. Ajay and Dr. Mohandas sir for giving their opinions and participating in the program. So thank you all. We'll meet in the next session. I think only one or two sessions will be there. And good luck for everyone. Thank you. Good night.
Good night, Rehana. Good night, Sabi.
Good night.